Good afternoon. I'm the chair of the Subcommittee on Planning and Dispositions, Councilmember Ben Kalos. I just want to take a moment to say how grateful I am that we've been fighting for paid family leave, and I was actually able to take it over the past 5 weeks and enjoy some very special time with my wife and newborn daughter. And that being said, and though I miss them, it is good to be back at work. And I want to welcome all of you to this hearing. I also want to thank Councilmember Ruben Diaz Sr. for being here early, and Councilmember Vanessa Gibson, and both of them are from the Bronx, for being here to make quorum so that we can vote. Today we'll be holding a public hearing on the Spofford Campus Redevelopment Special Permits and Disposition Application and Land Use Chair Salamanca's District in the Bronx. The relating zoning text and zoning map applications were subject of a prior hearing held in my absence on February 26th. We'll also be holding hearings on Special Project Loan Program 165 West 80th Street application and CUCS West 127th Street application. The Spofford Campus Redevelopment application is comprised of five related actions. First, disposition of city-owned property by ground lease, which means we're just going to lease away city property. A zoning map amendment to rezone an R6 to an M12/R72/MX-17 special mixed-use district, which means we're changing the character of the neighborhood from a lower-density residential neighborhood to one that is a higher-density residential neighborhood that can also be used for manufacturing. Third, a zoning text amendment to establish a special mixed-use district, map the project area as mandatory inclusionary housing area utilizing option one, and to modify loading berth requirements via special permit. Fourth, a large-scale general development special permit to modify the loading berth requirements. And five, a large-scale general development special permit to modify height and setback regulations. Approvals would facilitate redevelopment of the former Spofford Juvenile Detention Center into a five-building mixed-use project with approximately 740 units of affordable housing and light industrial, commercial, and community facility uses in the Hunts Point Neighborhood Community District 2 in the Bronx. I will now open the public hearing on land use items 33, 34, and 35, the two special permits and disposition action relating to the Spofford campus redevelopment. The
Now, see if there's any testify, and there won't be any, and then close it.
Are there any members of the public who wish to testify? Seeing none, I will now close the public hearing on the Spofford Campus Redevelopment Special Permits and Dispositions Actions. This is a great deal of work that happened through the land use chair, Salamanca. This is something he worked on before he was elected, and I have a statement I'll read on his behalf. Good afternoon, members of the Planning Dispositions Concessions Committee. It is with humility and excitement to inform you of my approval of the Peninsula, aka Spofford Campus Redevelopment in my district. After working on this project at a grassroots level since 2013, and now as the local council member, I'm proud to announce an agreement with the administration, developer, and community as a whole. The developer and administration have agreed to, first, the project will be 100% affordable with income bands ranging from 30% of AMI to 90% of IMAI, including 10% formerly homeless units as per HPD HDC term sheets. Developer will commit to a 60-year regulatory period for the balance of the residential units that are not permanently affordable per MIH. This is an increase of 20 years beyond the originally proposed 40-year regulatory period. Developer will include at least one 2,000 to 2,500 square foot space within Building 1A that could provide step-up space for local entrepreneurs, food step-up space, incubators, and so on. The developer has agreed to allow current Head Start provider La Peninsula to plan, recommend, and give feedback on the design and outfitting of the Head Start space. Labor and training, the development team has outlined in writing a variety of commitments, and they are making good to secure good jobs for local workers on the site and for Bronx companies to be given opportunity to participate in this project. And the developer commits to repairing the sidewalk on Tiffany Street between Berry Street and Spofford Avenue for the portion of the sidewalk adjacent to the Corpus Christi Monastery. Are there any questions or remarks from members of the subcommittee? I will now call for a vote in accordance with the recommendation of Chair Salamanca to approve all of the Spofford Campus Redevelopment Applications Land Use Items 31 through 35. Council, please call the roll.
Kalos.
Aye.
Gibson.
I want to congratulate Councilmember Salamanca and his team for achieving a great victory. We definitely need more affordable housing in the Bronx, so I'm very proud to vote aye and congratulate him and his team.
Diaz.
I would also like to congratulate Councilman Salamanca, the Bronx Board of President, and all of those involved in this magnificent and unique project in the Bronx. And yes, I vote yes.
The land use items are approved by a vote of 3 in the affirmative, 0 negative, and no abstentions. And
we will leave the vote open as we continue on with our public hearing. Our next hearing is on land use item number 41, the special projects loan application for project property at 165 West 80th Street in Manhattan. HPD seeks Urban Development Action Area Project UDAP approval pursuant to the General Municipal Law and 40-year tax exemption pursuant to the Private Housing Finance Law. Approvals would facilitate the transfer and rehabilitation of an existing building containing 39 studio apartments, Councilmember Rosenthal's district. I'll now open the public hearing on this application. And so just to be clear, there's a building. It was somewhat abandoned. People live there in studio apartments. That building is being turned over to a nonprofit to operate, to rehabilitate, to create one-bedroom apartments in so that folks can actually enjoy it. And then it's going to be turned over to the tenants to set up a cooperative. So we are incredibly excited about that. And we have a statement from Councilmember Rosenthal in whose district this project exists.
Thank you so much, Chair Kalos. And if I may say, you're a whole new man. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Hello. I'm just so pleased to support the application to create 100% affordable HDFC at 165 West 80th Street. This is a great step and an opportunity for affordable housing on the Upper West Side and for the tenants who have stuck it out for so long under incredibly difficult conditions. At a time when the Upper West Side is losing rent-regulated apartments hand over fist, it's more important than ever that the city take advantage of opportunities like these wherever it can. I want to thank HPD for their hard work getting to a deal, as well as the council's land use team. And I urge my colleagues under the leadership of Chair Kalos to support this application when it's voted on later this month. Thank you.
Sure, I'd like to now call the first panel. We have Nelson Chan from HPD, Artie Pearson, Director of Land Use at HPD, as well as Ken Ray from CATCH, and our council will swear you in.
Please state your names.
Nelson Chan.
Artie Pearson.
Ken Ray.
Do you affirm to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth in your testimony before this subcommittee and in response to all council member questions?
Yes.
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 Please begin.
Afternoon, Chair Kalos, members of the subcommittee. I'm Artie Pearson from HPD. Land use number 41 consists of the proposed disposition of a city-owned building located at block 1211, lot 47, and is known as 165 West 80th Street in Manhattan Council District 6. 165 West 80th Street is a 39-unit, partially occupied building that was taken into HPD's central management portfolio in 1985. Presently, the building is slated for substantial rehabilitation under HPD's Special Project Loan Program, which is administered by the agency's Property Disposition and Finance Division. Through the program, the sponsor will purchase the building for $1, complete renovations, and in this case, convert the property to cooperative ownership once occupants meet certain milestones such as rental achievement and home ownership training courses. HPD net leased the property to the current sponsor, Community Assisted Tenant Controlled Housing, or otherwise known as CATCH, in 2009. Disposition and redevelopment of the property was temporarily delayed due to a temporary restraining order granted to tenants in 2012. The case was overturned in favor of the city in May of 2017. The building is in its pre-rehab state, and as previously stated, there are 39 units, all of which are studios. Of the 39 units, 15 are occupied. During construction, there are significant vacancies allowing for checkerboarding, eliminating the need for temporary relocation. Post-rehab, there will be 20 studio units and 9 one-bedroom units, including a superintendent's unit. The scope of the work will include some structural joist replacement, as well as replacement of building systems such as electrical, plumbing, mechanical. The apartment interiors will include new bathroom and kitchen fixtures, meeting Green Initiative standards, new entry doors and windows. Sales prices for existing occupants will be $250 in accordance with the settlement, and the unit price for incoming shareholders has yet to be determined. Program guidelines for AMIs are capped at 120%. However, the AMIs for existing tenants will be capped at 60%. Maintenance is projected to be roughly $876 a month for studios and $1,106 a month for one-bedroom units, which is roughly 60% of AMI. The project also includes a small commercial and or community space, but the use for the space has not been determined. Under program guidelines, the sponsor will remain property manager for the first year post-cooperative conversion, after which the co-op will have the option to retain their services as property manager or select another organization. In addition to seeking disposition approval, the project also seeks Article 11 tax benefits that will coincide with the term of a 40-year regulatory agreement. Having the tax exemption in place will essentially offset debt service the shareholders will be required to pay upon the permanent construction loan, thus facilitating continued affordability. And we have briefed Council Member Rosenthal on this project, and we can answer any questions that you might have regarding this project.
I'd like to turn it over to the sponsor of this project.
Sure. Thank you, Chair Kalos. Just a quick question, refresh my memory again, for the current tenants, will they all fit into the AMI levels so they can stay?
Yes.
Congratulations. Can you come back to my district and do a few more projects?
We'll try.
Okay, I'll take you up on that. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. So I have a couple of questions that I like to ask, just so that folks who are watching at home and just members of the public have some transparency around the project. So I guess first question, who can move into these affordable units? What does their income need to look like? And how does that all work? If I'm watching at home, how do I get these affordable co-op in Councilmember Rosenthal's district, who is a great council member to have as a representative?
So the vacant units will go through Housing Connect lottery.
Great, and how much income does somebody need to make, is it just for people who are very low income? Is it for people who are higher income or middle income?
Well, the AMI incomes are capped at 120%, correct?
Yeah, and the current underwriting, we expect that we'll be able to limit that to 80% or less. Right now, we're looking at around 75%. And as the nonprofit sponsor, we would love to push it down as far as we can.
Okay, so as the nonprofit sponsor, you can't go any higher than 100%, 20% of AMI. Does anyone have that number, what that number is?
It's going to be for a one or or two-person household.
And you'd like to get that number down to 75% of AMI?
Right now, we are around 75%, somewhere between 75 and 80% as we work our way through the underwriting.
And currently, how many people live there?
15. Mm-hmm.
And those 15 people?
I'm sorry, that would be for the new people moving in, as we're looking at 75 to 80%.
And for the people who already live there, can they stay?
Yes, absolutely. It's a non-eviction plan.
And how much do they have to pay for to buy their apartment?
$250.
Great. And in terms of the new units, how much are those going to be sold for?
That hasn't been determined yet.
But it'll be it will be a certain percentage based on what a person making 120% of AMI earns?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Okay, do we have a figure for that? So folks at home who are wondering what AMI is and all that other stuff.
Yes, we do. If it's a single person, if we're looking in our range of 75%, that's somebody who makes about $50,000 a year.
Okay.
If it's a two-person household, because we are going to be creating some one-bedroom units in here, so the max family size under any circumstances that we would consider is two people. And that puts you into a similar range, little under 60,000, 61,000 probably the max.
Okay. And are you able to back into what you think the price range might be based on that for the one bedrooms or studios?
No, because yes, we ultimately will be, of mm-hmm. course. And those will be published well ahead of time.
Okay. And the maintenance on those units, if somebody wants to redecorate or something, does the maintenance spike, or is that maintenance fixed at a certain number?
The maintenance is going to be set initially by us at $876 a month for a studio, right. And $1,100
increases, right. As well.
And then the co-op will decide what increases after that, if any.
Will the co-op be restricted on how much they can increase on by?
I think I might have to get that
information. Retail restrictions, yeah. Certainly, right. But not on right. the...
And so in terms of the resale restriction, how does this work? So somebody buys a unit for $250 and then they can sell it for as much as they want, or how does it work?
There was a schedule provided by our program.
There's a schedule provided by our program that dictates how long folks live in there and how much they can resell for.
Okay, so can they sell to anyone, or do the people they sell to have to be within a certain income level?
Correct. Right, they will have to be right. within a certain income level, and this is monitored by a third-party monitor.
Great. And if one of the 15 people who currently lives there can't afford the $800 a month, are you evicting them, or what happens?
No. And what happens is we were successful, much to my surprise, in getting project-based vouchers. We have 8 vouchers for the project, Section 8 vouchers. I didn't know that it was possible to get those, but
award.
So
what is a project-based voucher?
It means it's a Section 8 voucher that will pay up to the rent for that size apartment, the maintenance charge, rather, for that size apartment, and the resident will pay 30% of their income. And currently, we have some residents in the building who are extremely low income. I'm talking $10,000 a year.
And in terms of they'll pay 30% of that, so that's like $3,000, and then the remainder, around $5,000, will come in through Section 8, where HPD will uh-huh. pay that.
So the building will be solid financially, and they will be protected as individual households.
In terms of the 15 tenants, are any of them currently disabled? Are any of them at risk of being disabled? And will they have a chance to move into units that are lower in the building?
Yes, let me first question, not that we know of. No one has exhibited that in terms of disabilities. There are some older people in the building, so I'm not sure how I'm supposed to qualify them as could become. I think we all could become.
We're all aging, so I guess
I'm a little further along than you are in that. But
when you're talking about a 60-year, sorry, this is a 40-year program over yeah. the next 40 years, and in 40 years I'll be 77. So if I got a top floor apartment, I might get tired of walking up all those steps.
We, in the projects that we've sponsored over the last 20 years or so, we've always made it a part of our project to allow for those kinds of transfers as part of the project, so that if we have somebody who's exhibiting those kinds of needs now, then we want to move them down beforehand. Our view is they lived in the building when it was in bad shape. They had to live through the construction. They're the ones that deserve it more than a new person coming in from the outside.
In terms of ADA accessibility, what types of accessibility features will come with the renovation, and what would be necessary from the city to be able to perhaps have an elevator?
Well, given that this project is not a senior building, having an elevator in the building would essentially require a redesign, lose more units that are being lost now with the combination of apartments. As the sponsor said, if there is a tenant in the building now that needs to be accommodated, they can move them into a vacant unit. Someone coming along later on, the board will have a chance to work with that person to see if there's a vacancy that person can move into. As far as the design of the apartments themselves, they're all built to be handicapped adaptable. So if someone needs to have their sinks lowered or something like that, there's the ability to do that.
Sure. Right. In terms of the source of funds, what kind of funding is the city providing for this project?
Right. So do you want to talk about the funding sources?
Sure. About 70% of the project will be coming through collegiate funds. There will be about 26% from a private lender, and 2% is from the developer.
Great. And I think just we'll have additional questions that we'll forward for answers, but I guess just for catch. So nonprofits are generally exempt from MWBE preferences and requirements. What is the minority and women makeup of executives at CATCH? And in terms of the contractor that you'll be using, have you selected an MWBE or MWBE subcontractors?
I'll start with CATCH. It's about 50-50 right now. Our contract, we have not selected our architect is or should be. If he's not, it's Hispanic so I was just asked that question as I came in, and it's like I have to figure if Carlos ever actually went through the verification.
The architect is Carlos Mieles, who's done a lot of work for HPD projects.
Great. Yeah. Well, and I know that Councilmember Rosenthal is the chair of the Women's Committee, so I know we'll continue to work on advocating for MWBEs in every single city project. So I think that's an end to the questions that I have here. If folks have additional questions, they can submit it to @BenKalos or email the questions and we'll pass them along. But we appreciate your testimony, and this is great work, and congratulations to you and Councilmember Rosenthal.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Are there any members of the public who wish to testify on this land use item?
So seeing none, you can close the public hearing on this application.
Seeing none, I will now close the public hearing on this application. Our next hearing is on land use item number 41, a special projects loan
Now you go back to page 5.
Move on to land use items 42 and 43, the CUCS West 127th Street Supportive Housing Application in Councilmember Perkins District in Manhattan. HPD seeks approval for an Urban Action Development Area project, UDAP, designating the project approval disposition of city-owned property and special permit to allow community facility floor area ratio to be applied to the development to create supportive and affordable housing. I will now open the public hearing on this application, and the council will now swear you in.
Please state your names.
Douglas James.
Artie Pearson.
Teresa Cassano.
Vianda Simmons.
Do you affirm to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth in your testimony before this subcommittee and in response to all council member questions?
Yes.
I do.
You may begin.
Afternoon, Chair Kalos. Again, I'm Artie Pearson from HPD's Office of Governmental Affairs. Land use numbers 42 and 43 are related ULURP actions seeking UDAP designation, disposition, and project approval for four city-owned sites located at 302 to 306 and 310 West 127th Street. That's block 1953, lots 36, 37, 38, and 40. and is known as CUCS West 127th Street in Manhattan Council District 9 under HPD's Supportive Housing Loan Program. The Supportive Housing Loan Program provides funds for the rehabilitation of existing buildings or for new construction buildings that provide supportive housing for the homeless, people with special needs, and other persons of low income. HPD works with the Department of Homeless Services as well as other public agencies to ensure that the completed projects meet programmatic guidelines. The sponsor of the project, the Center for Urban Community Services, proposes to combine two privately owned lots located at Block 1953, lots 39 and 41, with the city-owned lots in order to create an assemblage of six lots, forming the project area to be developed. The city-owned lots are all undeveloped with the exception of Lot 36, which is improved with a vacant building previously under DCAS's jurisdiction as it was transferred to HPD on February 28, 2018. Of the two privately owned lots, one is undeveloped vacant land, and the second is developed with two adjoining four-story buildings used as a traditional residence for homeless adults known as the Kelly Hotel. The current occupants of the Kelly Hotel will be permanently relocated to a location in Community Board 9. Under land use number 42, HPD seeks approval for the construction of one 12-story building, and upon completion, there will be 116 rental units for occupancy by homeless and low-income persons, plus one unit for a live-in superintendent, which is a two-bedroom. There will be a mixture of unit types, including 57 studios, 24 one-bedrooms, 32 two-bedrooms, and 5 five-bedroom apartments. Under program guidelines, 60% of the apartments will be supportive units, and the other 40% will be rentals for low-income households. Additionally, in accordance with program guidelines, incomes will be capped at 60% of the area median income. The estimated initial rents for formerly homeless tenants referred by DHS and other city agencies will be up to 30% of their income. Other tenants will pay rent set at up to 30% of 60% of AMI on an annual basis. The building will be constructed to meet enterprise green community certification guidelines such as low flow toilets, energy efficient lighting, and ENERGY STAR rated appliances. Amenities will include 24-hour security, a computer lab, gym, bike room, teaching kitchen, playground, outdoor courtyard, and a rooftop garden. The project also includes office space that will be used by CUCS to provide on-site social services. All residents will have access to the services, which include case management, mental health counseling, and referrals to additional services in the community. Also, HPD requests approval of land use number 43, which seeks approval of a special permit allowing for the modification of the zoning resolution. The proposed modification is to allow for an increase in floor area ratio that will be applied to nonprofit community facility institutions with sleeping accommodations. In order to facilitate construction of the CUCS West 127th Street project, HPD is for the Planning Subcommittee seeking approval for both land use number 42 and 43, and we briefed Councilmember Perkins on this project. Thank you.
Thank you.
So we have the sponsor here also who would like to go through a PowerPoint with you.
Great.
Okay.
Good afternoon, Chair Michalos. My name is Douglas James, Chief Operating Officer for the Center for Urban Community Services, CUCS. Thank you for having us. So CUCS is a nonprofit provider who provides services along the full spectrum for addressing the needs of homeless individuals and low-income individuals in New York City. We operate about 30 programs around the city where we provide services to the largest number of supportive housing units in the city, around 2,400 units. We are the lead agency in the Manhattan Outreach Consortium. We operate transitional shelter beds for street homeless individuals, and as a part of the DHS shelter system, we operate a wholly owned medical care subsidiary, Janian, that provides integrated psychiatry and medical services both to our own programs and programs operated by other nonprofits. We operate single stops, which are one-stop shops for connectivity to social services and benefits for low-income New Yorkers. And we operate a training institute, which provides training to a number of nonprofits around the city and around the country in best practices and evidence-based approaches to providing services. So the project at 302-314 West 127th Street is a supportive housing project. It'll have 117 units. It's a classic 60-40. 60% of them will be formerly homeless. 40 will be income-restricted units allocated through the HPD lottery, with half of them set aside for Community Board 10. As mentioned by HPD, we will have primary and behavioral health care services available on site for all residents of the building, case management services. There's a computer lab, a gym, a playground, indoor play area, case management services for ensuring connectivity to school for the children and the residents, and laundry and other amenities. Happy to take any questions.
Thank you. This looks like an amazing project. So I guess first question is how much does the total project cost to build all these great units, and what are the sources of funding?
So I'm Teresa Cassano. I'm the director of the Supportive Housing Loan Program, and I'll take this one. The total project cost is estimated to be under $80 million. The sources will consist of HTC bond proceeds, federal low-income housing tax credits. About 10% of the project will be from the Supportive Housing Loan Program. My program at HPD will be making a loan. We're also leveraging state funding through the Homeless Housing Assistance Program, as well as sponsor proceeds, NYSERDA funding from the state, and a borough president contribution.
And in terms of the supportive housing, I know that the mayor has given a pledge for that, so that is where that funding is coming from?
Yes, so the capital will be provided through the $15,000 commitment, as well as some of the service dollars. So the service award for families here is a leftover from the New York 3 commitment, so we are finishing up the city's side of that commitment, as well as the award for singles will be through the mayor's commitment for 15,000 units.
I appreciate the mayor's commitment. I was there when he announced it. The governor, in response, has also made a similar commitment. Are there state dollars from the governor's supportive housing funding in this project?
So we are leveraging state capital dollars from the Homeless Housing Assistance Program, which is a state agency. The service awards for this project are through the city, but in future projects, we also close deals with state awards.
Sure. And this project is not applying for an Article 11, which is a process that this committee usually deals with for tax abatement. Will this property be taxed?
This project is getting an as-of-right for a 20C tax exemption. The regulatory agreement will be for 60 years.
Great. And what happens at 60 years?
Well, at 60 years, the provider will come back to HPD, correct?
Yes.
Right.
Great. And in terms of the on-site supportive services, in terms of medical, mental health, are these just going to be small closet type size spaces, or how much space in terms of square footage are you dedicating to medical, mental health, social services?
So the entire lower subfloor basement is going to be devoted to office space and social services. It's the entire floor plate of the building. We, in order to accommodate the social services office, our architect designed an areaway in the back to allow natural light to penetrate to the lower floor. And that way, we move our social services to the lower floor, reserving the upper floors, the ground floor and above, for occupancy and residency, while providing adequate services for the entire building.
Will there be any, now in terms of the services that you're talking about, if I'm one of the 40% of the low-income folks who gets in, Am I able to use the same services?
It's a great question. Our approach is to not segregate or discriminate against anybody in the building. It's for two reasons. One, we don't want to stigmatize either the supportive housing residents or the income-restricted tenants. So when we try to create an integrated housing model, the services are available to everybody, irrespective of referral source to the housing. The other thing we find is that for income-restricted tenants, even though they don't come through the special needs application process, they come with a lot of the same needs that our formerly homeless tenants come with. And so they all benefit from the social services.
Some developers have taken amenities like gyms and computer labs and items like that and said that some tenants could use it and others can't. Will there be a distinction for the amenities?
Absolutely not.
Okay. In terms of the for the low-income housing, what income, if somebody is watching at home and is interested in moving into West 127th Street, when this gets built, what income thresholds if they're interested in this location?
So the income is capped at 60% of AMI, and the rent levels are set at 30% of 60% of AMI. So I'm not sure exactly what those numbers work out to.
So for a one-person household, so say a studio unit, those numbers are approximately $38,000 a year would be the income level. For a four-person family, we're talking under $55,000 a year.
And so this project is going to have 57 studios, 24 one-bedrooms, 32 bedrooms, 5 three-bedrooms. Are you just going to use the studios for the supportive housing, or are the units going to be distributed equally between the low-income and supportive housing?
So it's equally. It's just about over 50% of both the supportive units and the income-restricted units are for families, just above 50%. So for the supportive units, 36 units, 37 units are for supportive units for families, and 34 are for singles.
In terms of the building and its bulk, we are giving you a waiver. So normally you could build about 3.44. And my understanding, you can correct me if I'm wrong, is so for every square foot, normally you could build three times on top of it. That would be 3.44. And you're seeking to be able to build six times on top of it, about 6.2. And you're not going to actually build on the full lot. You're going to only build on half of it. So you're going to be able to build 12 times on top of that. Is that correct?
That is correct.
And in terms of that, is that the same? Are there other 12-story buildings in the neighborhood, or are you going to be the tallest building in the neighborhood?
It's in scale with other buildings on the block. In fact, directly across the street from the building facing it is another 12-story building with a similar setback in size density.
Okay. And all this is going to 100% affordable and supportive housing anyway?
Correct.
Great. I think you may have heard from the previous application, but something that's important to me is MWBE. This is not necessarily a project that I think would be covered, but in terms of your nonprofit, what does the executive leadership look like in terms of MWBE?
So
not MWBE, sorry, minority and women.
Thank you. I understood the question. So for our executive leadership, like the folks in the small room, about 30% of the people in that room are people of color. And 30% of them are women. As a nonprofit, you're not to be surprised, the bulk of our overall staff are women and people of color. And we strive to have all levels of the agency representative, not just the larger agency, but the folks that we serve.
And in terms of MWBE, for your contractor, your architect, and other people who are helping to build it, do you know what the makeup is?
So our architect is a women-owned business. The two principals are women, and they're not yet registered as MWBEs, but it's a woman-owned enterprise. And we haven't selected a general contractor yet. We are planning to work with the MWBE Accelerator, which is based in Central Harlem, funded through Citibank, to help coordinate our efforts to maximize utilization of MWBEs and local trades.
So speaking of local. What percentage of the project do you expect to be local hire? How many jobs are there going to be? And how do people in the neighborhood get a job putting up this housing?
We haven't selected a contractor yet, but as part of that process, we hope to work with whoever the successful bidder is and ensure that they focus their attention on maximizing those numbers.
If before our vote you're able to just share with us a goal that you may have worked out with that contractor or that you plan to provide to a contractor that should bid. And along those lines, what kind of jobs are these? Are these jobs where people will have, if they get hurt on the job, health insurance to cover that injury, or if, God forbid, they get disabled on the job, disability to supplement workers' compensation, and will they be paid an area a rate that is competitive with area standards?
So it will be a prevailing wage job. So
so we will be paying Davis-Bacon wages, which are published by the federal government.
And will there also be a requirement for health insurance and disability?
I think we'll have to work with the selected contractor to understand.
Great. And I think one last question that I had just on the property. So one of the property, sorry. So two of the properties in this group are from CUCS.
Yes.
And then one of them is a one-story building that's been turned over from DCAS.
Correct.
And three properties are vacant. That is land that's owned by HPD. How much is that being, how much are those four properties being sold for?
The city-owned properties will be conveyed for a dollar.
In terms of it, do we know what the appraised value of those properties together are?
I don't have that information with me right now.
Would you share it with us later?
Sure.
Perfection. I think those are all the questions that I have during this public hearing. I want to thank you for the great work that you're doing. If you're interested in building supportive housing on the Upper East Side, we are desperate for it. And would love to have some in the mid-block. If you did not know, in my district, you get an as-of-right floor area bonus if you build in the mid-block. I will say it shouldn't just be hospitals and private schools using it, so we'd love to have more supportive housing, and we would be there to welcome you with open arms. We will forward additional questions as may be and hope that you'll respond. So I will excuse this panel. Are there any members of the public who wish to testify? Seeing none, I will now close the public hearing on this application. Land use items 41 through 43 are being laid over. I'd like to thank our counsel, Julie Lubin, and the land use staff for preparing today's hearing, and the members of the public and my colleagues for attending.
Don't adjourn. We're gonna hold the vote for.
And we will hold this hearing open until 3:20. Thank you.
Still,